So, but anyways, yeah, Rekordbox. And as you can see, I have a bazillion lists because I like keeping, oh, it's on the left again. I like keeping past sets just because sometimes like I create mashups and I can go back and say, hey, I remember like creating a mashup for this set, and I can go back and like look at it. I thought you guys said you could only hear the voice on the left side. Oh, you said it was more sound. Oh, my bad. Let me check. Let me go back. That's an easy fix. So, mic, advanced property. It is weird because according to OBS, everything is centered, so it shouldn't be more on the left. But you could hear me on both ears now because I switched it back on to mono. So you can hear in both ears. It's not more to the left or more to the right. Okay, we'll just keep going. It's not going to be perfect. Just bear with me, guys. So I think one of the hardest things for me, let's see. See, I have a 2i2. And my mic only has one port. I don't have two ports. And it's plugged into my computer via USB, so. But, yeah, I mean, it's a very basic mic. I got it on mono price, but it does, you know, what I've needed it for. So, yeah, the hardest thing for me anytime I ever put a set together is trying to think of a good opening. And it's a little bit harder now because I don't know, it's for me, I don't know, like I usually have like a couple ideas of like tracks, like, so I'm gonna say this right now, I do plan sets, but very loosely. They're kind of like guidelines to me. Like I can go in and out of it if I need to, I can move stuff around. But for a lot of people that are starting out, I really think it's a good idea to get into that just until you feel comfortable. Because I can also freestyle it. Like I can go and start something and just like play and not know what I'm going to play or when I'm going to play songs and just kind of go with the flow. So I've done both. But the opening song is always the hardest for me. And I kind of base it based on my time slot. So when I used to be more into like opening slots, I didn't really care as much because when you're an opener, which a lot of you guys will find out as you start DJing live, except for like maybe now that everything's digital, doesn't really go with that. But when you're an opener, most of the time the clubs won't let people in until like a few tracks in. So word of advice, don't put any tracks that you absolutely want people to hear at the very beginning of your set. You just kind of want them as fillers. As you get onto later time slots, you might want to put more consideration into your opening track. And like even BassCon's a good example of this. I've seen it numerous times and sometimes they won't even let you in like 30 minutes into it. And it's just because, you know, there's like a line, they have to sort it, they have to search you, it takes some time to get to the stage. So just always think about that stuff. Because there's nothing worse than like having like a track that you just produced and you're like, oh my gosh, I can't wait for people to hear this. And then all of a sudden there's still nobody in the room and you're just like, hey, should I play this again? Are they recording the set? You know, you try to think about all these things. So try to have tracks that you really want people to hear like towards the middle or end as a safeguard. Now, if you're playing a later time slot, obviously, you can have more of a structure to your set and worry less about that stuff. But you want to kind of base it on the time of the night too. So for me, if I'm a hard style DJ and I have house before me and I have like something a little bit harder and faster after me, like hardcore, I might start with a more mellow track and then kind of build myself into the set. But you also have to think about like the crowd, and you know, you don't want to start with something that's like super slow, super euphoric, that might lose them, because there's nothing worse than seeing people leave during your set. And it's going to be like a learning experience, and it's always going to be different from city to city, venue to venue, audience to audience. It's really hard to predict. And even like, you know, a hardstyle crowd, you know, you can just pick the wrong track. So just kind of, my whole idea is if you're having fun and you're like, you know, going hard and not just sitting there and just kind of like doing this and not engaging, the audience is going to love you no matter what. Because if you have a passion for it and they see it, that's like you selling yourself to the crowd. Like, you're having fun, they should have fun. So, see, that's it. So, that's a good example. I mean, going from dubstep to, or from tech house to like dubstep and drum and bass, that's definitely a very different experience. And I've had that where I've gone like, oh man, when I played in, Fresno at, Electric Fairy Tale, I played like after a trap guy and I kind of had a wacky set and I was going at the same time as Kutsky. So I wasn't expecting to have a huge crowd. And I actually had a pretty decent crowd, and because I'm so, kind of random with my music, like I have a passion for just good music. And so I'll throw in like hardstyle, it's got elements of psytrance or dubstep. I'll even throw just dubstep tracks in there. Anything that I just feel like that can flow together in the set, I will throw it in there. And a metal step track. Yeah. I used to be the kind of person that would just say, YOLO, I'm just going to play whatever I want to play. And I won't say the show that I played at, but I played after a trap duo and I played like a 10 o'clock slot. And, it was in Sacramento. And it was probably the largest crowd I'd played at. The first largest crowd I've ever played at. And typically, like, bass heads, not really, like, super into hardstyle, but I had some fans that had messaged me saying they were super excited for my set. So I did kind of, like, a different set, and I put that into consideration. Not to change my style, but you definitely have to play the game a little bit. And just say, you know, there's a good way to introduce people into hard style, and there's also a wrong way. Like, you can't just say, like, F the crowd and just, like, play, like, the, like, raw stuff. Like, that's probably going to be a turnoff, and you're probably not going to get any bookings after that. But I played, like, a lot of, like, I played some remixes. I played some dub style. That was the first time I ever played, like, Talon's track live. And people were headbanging so hard, they almost flipped over the rail, and that was an amazing feeling. But the duo that I went after, or the duo that went after me, so I was before, I had trance before me, which actually makes a little bit more sense, because a lot of hard cell influences from trance. I had a trance guy before me, and then I had trap after me, but it was like melodic trap. And the duo that was going after me loved my set. Like, they were like, that's just an amazing set, like, I don't hear a lot of hard sell, and they gave me props on it. But one of the promoters said I went too hard for my time slot, but the head promoter that booked me knew what I played. And, you know, I just kind of like, the whole thing is like, the biggest argument is, do you go harder than like the headliners? Cause it was definitely headliners after me. But for me, I probably should have done a little bit more research, to be fair, to figure out what kind of music they played. Because I'm not, like, really big into, like, the trap scene, but, you know, there are subgenres of trap, including, like, hard trap or trap style. And I could have, like, gone a little bit lighter, but honestly, I had such a blast, and the crowd really enjoyed it. And the guys after me seemed to, like, really respect me, so I don't think that that was a big deal. However, I would say to a certain point. So if you're going to, like, say if I'm opening up for a raw style artist, I may go on the lighter side of Hardstyle and do like reverse bass, maybe a little bit of euphoric, and maybe some like light raw or end with raw to kind of get them warmed up to it. But I probably wouldn't do an all raw set, and I certainly wouldn't end in hardcore. So just, you know, kind of be considerate about your time slot, what time it is, who's playing before you, who's playing after you. Because the best thing to do during a show is to have a flow. Part of that is the responsibility of the promoters, in my opinion, and having been a promoter. But sometimes it doesn't work out. Sometimes you just have to stick people, you know, where you can fit them. And so I get that too. So just kind of be like somewhat considerate about that stuff. Yeah. You said exactly what I was saying when I wasn't looking. So, yeah, and that's the other thing too. It's like with Gabber, it's a faster genre. It's one of those things where you have somebody who, because another thing that goes into consideration for promoters is they book it based on popularity or like headliners. Like, is this person more of an opener? Or are they more of a closer? And that could have been maybe the situation. I don't know. But sometimes it's poor booking and sometimes it's them just trying to fit you in there. Because sometimes they just book people and they don't worry about the order until it gets closer to the show. But for me, when I'm doing shows, I try to be considerate of both. And I try to think of that ahead of time. But it's also like, what are you going to do if somebody can't play and you have to fill that like time slot and you can't get the same genre? So, you know, it's not always going to work out, but just try to be considerate for the most part. Yeah. And Forest Green, I think, plays primarily, like, she does, like, was it house and, like, just do trance, too? I think it's mostly house. But, yeah, it's definitely a very different energy, but, you know. Anyways, so I have somebody who booked me to play a show in December. So I might use this as a basis for that, kind of loosely. And, you know, the other thing, too, is you'll, like, start working on a set. And if you're good about it, you won't wait, like, last minute like I do. I usually wait till the week of, which is really bad. But for me, I don't know. I feel like if I overpractice, it makes me overthink it. And then I find myself doing more mistakes. Like, I usually never practice the day of a show. I might open up Rekordbox and loosely practice on Rekordbox, but I won't practice on physical gear. So, yeah. I have no idea if I'm the only person playing, which would give me a lot more freedom, or if there's other people playing. But I'm going to go on the assumption that I am playing by myself. So one thing that's nice to do is to just kind of like go through your music and pick out tracks that you like and just drag them into a brand new folder. So I have this one just titled as Fun for this playlist. And what I'll usually do is, obviously, if I have sets, a lot of the music I've played and enjoyed like most recently will be in those most recent sets. Maybe not so much right now because I'm not playing a lot because I've been focusing on school. Nothing wrong with that, right? So, let's see. Then again, okay, so let's see. And the other thing too is I have like some, so my, if you were to see my folders and how they're organized, like just like my music, on my desktop, I have genres for the most part, because sometimes like genres overlap, and then I'll have like artists in there. And the artists, it's kind of hard because some artists like go into multiple genres. Like you have some raw artists that will do like gated kicks, which can kind of go either way, or they do like multiple types of hard styles. So I'll usually put those kinds of guys like just in the general hard style, but then I also have like a raw style folder within that. And if like a raw style artist is one other type of hard style, I'm like, whatever, I'll just put them and keep them in the raw style folder. So that helps me, like, if I'm trying to find a specific like type of song, it helps me like look. But for the most part, I have these folders over here too. And I also have these folders here, like you'll see, I know it's probably kind of small on the screen. I don't know how well you guys can see it, but I have Hardstyle 1 and Hardstyle 2. As of a few months ago, this was like all of my Hardstyle, and I just like dragged my Hardstyle folder into this. But I have so much Hardstyle, I had to put it on two USBs. So like Hardstyle 1 has, oh, it's not in order. Let's see. 549 songs. And Hardstyle 2 has 587. So I try to keep it like somewhat split because I want to keep room on those USBs for actual like playlists too. One thing to keep in mind too, when you guys do export onto your USBs, if you have like multiple, like the same song in multiple playlists, it's not going to count as extra storage. So like I can have multiple folders and have like the same music, because when you make an edit on any of these tracks, it's going to be the master file in Rekordbox, unless you duplicate it and, you know, make another copy of that file. But you'd have to do that on your desktop and then drag it over. So one thing to keep in mind is when you guys do get to the point of, you know, you've created a playlist, you want to go, you want to right-click on it, and then you will go to export playlist. It's, there's nothing plugged in for me to export it onto, but you click the USB you want to export it onto. If you drag a playlist onto the USB, it will take the original file from your desktop, which is not the Rekordbox analyze file. So if you have any hot cues or any cue points or any kind of things that you've done in Rekordbox, it won't transfer over. That's why you have to export it in Rekordbox. That's very, very important. I had a friend come over on Halloween and she did that. And so what happens is when you plug into the CDJ, it won't show the wave and it won't show any analyst. So you won't see the key, you won't see the BPM. It'll just have like the track name and maybe like the artist, and that's about it. So the files in Rekordbox are a duplicate of the one on your desktop. Now, keeping that in mind, Rekordbox is not super intelligent. So organize your files before you start putting them in Rekordbox. And if you do move them, you have to redrag them into Rekordbox because it remembers the file from where it was when you originally dragged it into Rekordbox. Now, the other thing you can do too, you can also do it from iTunes. And from that, you know, it's pretty much attached to iTunes. I had an issue, and I don't even know how this happened, but iTunes actually reanalyzed a bunch of my tracks and lowered the quality. And I had to buy a bunch of new tracks because I had also decided at that time to delete a bunch of old backups. Not super intelligent. But yeah, so when you're dragging your files into a playlist from the original desktop source, don't ever move that music. Because what's going to happen is, let's see, I think I found it earlier. When you try to click to play on a track, like this one, Lose It All, Brennan Heart, there's a little explanation point right here saying, oh no, I can't find it. You moved it, you stupid bitch. So I also went through and filtered a bunch of like tracks, and maybe it was a lower quality track that I deleted. That was like what I did at the beginning of quarantine. I went through all of my tracks and I looked at the quality and I made sure they were either wave or the highest like MP3. And speaking of which, there is a huge argument between MP3 and WAVE and which one has better quality. And I've read some like research and supposedly WAVE has the better quality, but when you do, a blind test and people are listening just on headphones, you can't really tell. I don't think it really makes a huge difference until you're on a bigger setup. Just because it's kind of like it's a lossless thing with the wave. So if you can, if you're buying tracks, try to buy the wave. Because I know some of you guys are just starting to get into the whole DJing thing. And it's going to be a pain if you, I know it's like a dollar difference. But there's nothing worse than buying a track and then having to go back and rebuy it, you know, for that time you finally get your big booking. So it's better to start earlier than later. It is a huge file size, but you want the good sound quality if you're going to get to that point. And the other thing too, when you guys are using USBs for gigs, don't do anything higher than 32 gigabytes because some of the older models of CDJs cannot read anything bigger than that and it will error out. So always carry at minimum 3 USBs on you because if you have one USB error out, you have another one as like a backup and you can have, and if you have an issue where the CDJs do not link, where they do not connect together, and you have that same problem, then you still have a backup. Heck, if you can have 4, keep 4 on you. Well, if you don't have a terabyte hard drive, you get an external hard drive, and you just keep, you know, you can plug in your external hard drive and run Rekordbox with it. You just have to make sure that it's plugged in. Otherwise, it's going to be like, where the heck is all this music? And don't move anything on that hard drive. Terabytes are so cheap right now. I have my... Let me see. Sorry, it's going to get super bright. I have my super ancient... I don't know if you can see it in the corner down there. My iOmega 1 terabyte. It literally is the size of the new Macs, like the PC Mac things. It's literally like a brick, and that's 1 terabyte. And when I bought it, it was like $200, like 12 years ago. Nowadays, you can get something slimmer, like I have one that's like the size of my phone, 2 terabytes, and I got it for like, I don't know, like $80 or something. So, no excuses. So anyways, I know I'm throwing a lot of information at you guys because like, I swear I have ADHD and it's like, I just think it's something I'm like, oh, I have to talk about that. Okay, getting into building a set. So I am going to just kind of like pick a couple of tracks that I like. So I'll pick a couple from, let's see, Hard Hub was a fun show. So I will, let's see, I'm not going to do any hardcore. I'm just going to stick with Hardstyle. So I will move that into my fun folder. I'm going to go into Hopped Up, and obviously, like, I have a bunch of, like, tracks in here that I like. I'm going to, like, cut it off and not do, that one's Frenchcore. So let's see. I'm going to move that to fun. And if there's any duplicate tracks, it'll say there are duplicates. Do you want to skip them or do you want to add them? So you can hit skip and it'll still add everything else. And you just want to start with more than not enough tracks because then you can kind of like have the flow. And I'm going to talk about like very loosely like mixing and key and how that works in this program. Let's see. I might even remember some of these playlists. So Remedy is a newer one. So I will move that in there and skip. And you can tell that like I've got a lot of stuff in there that I repeat in my sets just because I have, obviously I have tracks that I really enjoy. Yeah, 4 terabytes will last you a long time. Because even though Wave is, like, bigger, it's going to take a lot for it to actually fill it up. So let's see. I don't know if that's already in there. It is. I have a couple of mashups. that I like to do occasionally. That in there. And the person that booked me did say I had like freedom to play whatever I wanted, so that was nice. I have like a bunch of like, you know, happy stuff too that I kind of like to mix as well. Depending on my mood, I'll either end in happy hardcore or Frenchcore. So I think that's a pretty good start. I might throw some size stuff in there, size style. And I have like a dubstep folder. I don't have a bunch of dubstep. I think I actually need to drag my folder in here and add some stuff. But I do have, you know, some stuff in here, so I could maybe throw a few in there and see if I can fit them in there. Got like my happy mix, or I was like gonna do happy hardcore, maybe happy hardstyle. Electric fairy tale. So here's an example. So electric fairy tale, this was like the first track that I played. I'll play the first two tracks that I played when I played there. If it lets me. I don't know why I did not drag. There we go. Okay, so I'm glad that I'm seeing this. So you can see it's defaulting and not going to the first beat. So this is one thing that happens when you update Rekordbox. It might throw the beat grid off, and I'm actually gonna show you how to fix that. So you want to zoom in as much as you can. I actually have the a cue point for the first beat for when this happens, which is a nice thing to like kind of save. But you want to zoom as much as you can, and you can even go to one player on the specific track, and you can even like zoom in more than this. Because you want to, actually, no, that zoomed in as much as it'll go. So you can see it's trying to say that this is the first beat when clearly it's over here. This is the first kick. So if I had it, if I didn't have the cue point set up, I can do this and I would click over here to grid and I would hit this little line right here and that would reset it. And then if I wanted to save that cue point, I would go back to cue, is it there or, oh, I would hit cue and that would go to memory and it would pop up over here. Now say, say it's like back over here. If I have it and I just updated Rekordbox, I'm like, okay, I saved this. I know that's the first beat, the first kick. I can just hit the timestamp over here. Click that button again, and it will fix the beat grid. And then you hit Q, because you want it to like start from there. Yeah, it is. Yeah, I am going to go over how to select tracks by key. And yeah, I'll go over like a cue points a little bit. Like I'll kind of go over like the structures of the tracks as well, because that's definitely important to know when you're mixing. But I'm just going to kind of like just go with the flow, and as stuff comes up, I'll talk about it. So like this was a good example to come into, because like you said, this happens a lot and it's really annoying. But that's why I say, you know, use the memory, so that way, you know, you can always at least go to that first beat. And there is also another thing that Rekordbox does when it reanalyzes and it updates. Sometimes it'll throw the BPM off. Like for instance, like maybe this track will say 149.99, but you clearly know it's 150. If you change it right here, it'll change the number on here, but it won't actually change the beat grid to reflect that, if that makes any sense. Um, So if you go into here and you go to grid, you can change it right here. And for people that are just starting out and they're relying on their eyes, which is fine. Eventually, I want you guys to blindfold yourself or put like tape over the screen so you can't see, so you can truly know how to beat match. But just to start out with, you know, that that's fine. And for people who like say, like, you know, for example, like, oh, the people use sync and it's so easy. There's a lot that goes into it, because if you use sync and it's off, the beat grid's off, it's actually not going to do anything for you. It will actually mess you up if you rely on that. So A, don't rely on the sync button. But B, if you're going to start out that way to learn how to like to mix and practice, you got to set this up first. So yeah, if it says 149.9, you have to be in the one player mode. You cannot do in the two player mode. So this little like a menu down here, normally it would look like this. And if you have a controller, it is going to look a little bit different, but you should still have the same elements. So, because this is the free record box, it's not the paid plan. So you go to one player, it'll default you on the cue loop. You have to hit on grid, and then you would change it on there. So I'll give you, here, I'll do it right here, and I'll give you an example. So let's have it at 149.99, enter. And I'll show you guys what I mean. Because that 0.1 may not seem like a big difference, but you will see the grid slipping eventually. I'm actually going to zoom out a little bit so it's not like super close. So you can kind of see that. I've never actually tried to go backwards, so hopefully this will be a good example. And it probably won't even notice it until like in here, which if you zoom in, I'm going to pause it. You can see the beginning of the kick should be right here. It's not that big of a difference, but it could be enough to hear when you're mixing. So you can kind of see that, but notice this. I am going to go back to 150, press enter, and you see the whole beat grid move over. Yeah, so I don't have pro mode, but I think in theory you should be able to analyze and do all this stuff, and it will transfer into pro mode because it's like using the same files from Rekordbox. So analyze stuff in Rekordbox, you know, before you mess with it. It's gonna be some good advice. Okay, and then the other thing too is, Care Bear, I know you had asked about where to buy music. If you're buying Hardstyle, number one place I would go to is Hardstyle.com. When you buy it, is in euros. You can do it through PayPal, so it'll do It'll do the currency exchange for you, so you will pay a little bit more. But if you have a PC, it will analyze and work with Rekordbox, and it'll have the track title and the artist in the appropriate spots. Otherwise, if you can't find a track or you're doing like a different genre, you can do Beatport. The problem with Beatport, if you have a PC, it doesn't work. It's not very PC friendly. And so it'll have like a bunch of numbers, the track title and maybe the artist. And you have to go back and edit all that stuff out so that it looks like it does on this screen right here. Just kind of a pain in the butt. They have Beatport Pro. You can find it for PC. It's a very outdated program. They haven't updated it. At least not that I've checked the most recent months. But as far as I know, they still haven't updated it. It's like from years ago. It is more friendly towards Macs. So if you have a Mac, Beatport Pro, and you have the app and you download it on your Mac, it will analyze it like this. But if you're buying it just off the website, it won't. So just be aware of that. And I do buy some stuff on Beatport because Hardstyle.com doesn't have everything. I even had issues like when I was self-releasing and like reached out to them to put my tracks on there. they said they only do it through labels, and even BassCon, I don't think, releases on Hardstyle.com, so they're mostly doing, like, the European labels. So, yeah, just a FYI. iTunes,
I've read mixed reviews on it, and they're supposed to be lossless, but supposedly they're actually compressed, so I would just kind of stay away from that. Don't do any, like, ripping from YouTube, obviously for copyright reasons, but also it's terrible quality. It's fine, I guess, if you're going to, like, practice, you're not going to really do anything with it, but just don't. Also, knowing the difference between getting an extended mix and, a DJ edit or radio edit, so, and that's, I guess that's a good way to transfer into the structure of a track.
Yeah, exactly. The highs and mids are everywhere, and sometimes you get, like, the bass boosted channels, and they're just garbage, because it's basically, like, ripping a track off of a video versus having the original audio source. So yeah, just don't do the YouTube rips. It's garbage. This is pretty good, by the way. This is an oatmeal stout from Trader Joe's. Pretty good. Okay. Structure of the track. Very basic. I'm going to zoom out a bit. Go to the beginning. So, you have the mix intro, which is usually very, very basic. Like, you have, like, some maybe, like, hi-hats, you have some kicks, maybe some melody, but it's very basic compared to, you know, the middle and the end. So here you go. You might have some, like, vocals thrown in. So if you're, like, cutting, you can bring in just pull that up, pull the other track down for this, and bring it back. So you can tell it's literally, like, the introduction for a track. It's like when you're reading a book, you don't get thrown into, like, the middle of the story, like, you build up to it, and that's what this is. Now, if you have a radio edit, usually what they do is they will cut out that whole mix intro, which there is a way to mix with it, but what I'm going to do is show you guys a cookie cutter way of mixing Hardstyle, which is very good for beginners. It's not always 32 bars. Usually it's actually 16 bars, which I'll get into explaining about bars in a second. So if it's a radio edit, usually it'll just start, like, with a crash or just, like, this little bit of the track. Because if you're just listening, you're not mixing, you don't really care about the mix intro. No, we don't do this like we used to. So it would start, like, in this area. Take it back to the roots, you know? And there are different areas where you can mix. You have a little mid part right here. You have, like, another drop down here. And then you have what's called the mix outro. So I'll play this one right here. All right, have a good one. Thanks for watching. But yes, I will put it up. So, give the mid intro. First drop. Headhunters. So you can hear it's much different than the mix intro. It's got a lot more elements to it. And theoretically, you could mix out of this. Excuse me. If you're doing quick mixing, which is a lot what I do, I usually play, like, my short attention span will do, like, most time a minute and a half of a track, but if a crowd is really feeling a track, I will play it out more. You have another drop down here. And you can see it's got a change to it. It's got more of a melody in it. And then the mix outro is basically, you know, wrapping everything up. So you will still have, like, some melody, but the very last few bars, like, usually the last 8 bars, will go back to, like, it was with the mix intro. And the reason for that is if you're doing the cookie cutter way of Hardstyle mixing, you're going to use the mix outro as a point to use to do the mix intro with the next track.
So this track would be the mix outro, the new track coming in, you would mix using the mix intro, and so it kind of just like glides well, really well together. So you still hear like that melody. It's kind of using elements from different parts of the track. And the more you listen to Hardstyle, the more predictable it is for the most part. I truly enjoy tracks that are not predictable. Like, I like fake drops, and even though it's just like, oh, when you're in the crowd, you're dancing, you're like, oh, I missed it, or I was too soon. And then when you get to the end, you hear that there's more elements being taken out of it. So, I hope that kind of makes sense. So, there is that. And I'm going to show you, like, for EFT, how I used this track and mix into my next one. And I will point out the structure. So, zoom in as much as I can. Oh, I guess I didn't change it and save it. There we go. Okay. So, oh, that's why, because I didn't save it after I changed it from 149. Oh, let me go back. Hold on 1 second. 150. Q. Nope. Back there, Q. Oh, the other thing you need to do sometimes if you're messing with that, if it doesn't save it right here, you might just need to redrag it. And then usually it'll fix it. Like if it still says 149 after you did the changes, just redrag the track and let it refresh. So I'm not going to really go over the structure for dubstep because it is so much different. And I just want you guys to focus on, you know, just one thing at a time. But you can see that the point where I mix in the dubstep track is like much further in because it's kind of weird to like mix over this stuff. So anyways, actually, I guess screw that. I'm going to go with the Hardstyle track. So it's Hardstyle and Hardstyle. Makes sense. So I have my mix intro queued up on my track right here. I'm going to do my best to mix with my mouse. It may not sound perfect. Just kind of bear with me because it's really hard to do it. This is where a controller would come in handy if I had one. So I have, you know, the track and say it's like getting to the end. I'm going to bring the crossfader up towards A because that's the main track. And when it gets to that last little kick, I went and press play. And I'll kind of like bring it more towards the middle of it. And the kicks should be overlapping each other like this. It should not be like off. Kind of like pull it down, bring it up, that way you can kind of hear it a little bit better. And so at the very end, that is very common for a Hardstyle track where it'll just kind of like do the, and it's not that you're like getting off sync, it's just part of like a lot of Hardstyle tracks. It's like kind of like building up like the hype and like, oh, the new track's starting or whatever. So you just want to be careful how you mix that. And I'm not going to go over like the very detailed parts of mixing, like highs, mids, and lows. I'm just showing you guys the basics on how to like do it in Rekordbox as it is. Yeah, the drum roll. I like making my noises, okay? I'm making my own drum roll. So then you have like the next track in.
Hello again.
And another reason why I don't like to wait until the mix outro to mix is because, you know, I can like play with like some effects, or I can play a little bit with like different knobs, or do like the hot potato thing you see a lot of DJs, like they act like they're touching stuff, moving stuff, but they're not, just to look like they're doing something. I don't really like faking it. Terrible actress, cannot do that shit. So, I'll usually like mix on the mid intro.
Home is in the cosmos amongst my stars.
Let me get my next track stars up here.
Are they are made by me.
And that's the other thing. So if you don't press pause or cue when you drag the track up, it's automatically going to start. And so cue, the difference between play and cue, as long as you're holding it, it'll play the track. But if you let go, it'll go back to the point that the cue had stopped. If you press play, it just keeps playing the track. If you press play, then pause, and you hit cue, it creates a new cue point. So that's kind of good to have if you just kind of like want to mess around with the track and just, I don't know, do stuff. If you want to like repeat vocals, it's like almost like a manual hot cue kind of, where it's like repeating something. You can kind of like go back and just have it doing that. But yeah. Also, if you're on a keyboard and you don't have a controller, if you hold shift and space, it'll play track B, which is your bottom track. And if you just press space, that'll start your top track. And if you do shift C, that'll do Q for your bottom track. And then just C will do your top track. Just in case you didn't know. Bam. Okay. I'm gonna go ahead and fast forward it. You can see the cue of where I like last paused. The little triangle. Oh no, it didn't press play. I guess you have to click on it in order for the spacebar to work. And I only have it on sync because it's really hard to do it on a mouse and keyboard. But if you have the beat sync off, you can adjust the platters with these little arrows right here. But you can see how like I kind of transitioned and I went smoothly from one track to another. And I did it in the middle of the track. I didn't even have to do it at the end. Because usually like after a drop, it'll get kind of like quiet. Unless there's like heavy vocals, and sometimes the vocals will continue into it. If you cut off vocals, it never sounds good. It's really important for you to know your tracks. So I don't know if anybody has any questions. But yeah, that's just kind of like the basics of mixing. So let's create a set. So fun. Let's see, I don't even remember what this track is. Okay, why not? I'm gonna use this as my opening track. It's 128. Now, see the difference on why it has to be in one player if you wanna switch this permanently. For the BPM to like fix the beat grid. Because in one player, if you fix it in the grid, it'll do it permanently and mess with the beat grid. But if you do it in two player, it messes with the BPM beats per minute temporarily. So that way you can speed it up to match your next track or slow it down or whatever. So, this one's 128. I'm going to kind of go up to almost like a middle ground between them. So I'm going to do 140. And if you have it on sync on this, which is only okay with Rekordbox, don't do it like on actual like DJ gear. then it'll automatically sync the BPM on the lower track. So I'm going to go ahead and listen to this track so I can like kind of figure out where the first kick is, because depending on the person playing before me, if I was playing live, I might try to mix out of their set into my set, or I might just like let it play out or do a backspin and then just start playing my track, depending on, you know, what they're playing. And actually, we'll just play from the beginning. I'm gonna zoom out because I really don't need to be that close. So, bars. So every red bar is a full beat. Anything in the middle is a quarter of a beat. So, you know, one quarter, one quarter, one quarter, one quarter equals one. And when I count in my headphones, I will count the full beats and the quarter beats. And I'll count it as 1, 2, 3, 4, 2, 2, 3, 4, 3, 2, 3, 4. And in my head, like, if I already know the song and I can, and I don't even have to count, I know where it is, I still, like, beat to the tap, or beat to the tap, tap to the beat. So I'll do it, and then, like, when I get to, say, it's a very short, like, mix, and it's only 8 bars, I'll do 8, 2, 3, play. If it's usually you have, like, 16 bars is, like, the stereotypical, like, mix intro or mix outro that I would do, I count in eights. I don't count up to 16. It's just easier to do it in shorter numbers for me. So then I'll do it again. Like, I count, you know, 8, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 2, 2, 3. When I get all the way up to the second 8, 2, 3, 4, then I press play for the next track. So that's how I do it. So if you're brand new to this, just tap to the beat. And it's really easy in hardstyle because that's what the kick is. And even, like, in the dubstep, you can hear it. So, and if the nice thing about, like, having the wave right here is you can actually kind of see, like, where that pinkish, reddish color is. That's pretty much where the main beat is. So when it actually drops on the first beat, I'm actually gonna probably just go ahead and start mixing in. But before I do that, I need to figure out which track I'm gonna use, and I'm gonna show you guys how to mix and key. Yeah, so you get a little bit of everything with this. I am not a expert in music theory, but this is a good learning tool. And you can actually even, like, Google circle of fifths, and there'll be, like, a nice little wheel. And actually, you can kind of start to see the patterns and learn how music theory works on why things are in key. I played the violin when I was really, really little, trying to get back into it. Just been kind of bad with it lately. But I think because of that, I can hear when things are out of key. Because on a violin, if things aren't played right or your finger is slightly off, you can hear it, and it does not sound good. So, I take pride in that gift I have achieved as a child. It's like my superpower. Just very terrible if you know how to mix and key, and you hear people who don't know how to mix and key, and even worse, don't care that they're not mixing in key. Anyways. So, right here, you will see that there is a pull-down menu. It says Master Deck Traffic Light, which if you click on that, and you click on Master, it will highlight anything that is in key with the Master. And the Master is the one that's lit up here. What I just like to do is I go on to, if I'm trying to find something that mixes well with track A, I click track A. But if you do not actually click on this right here, it will not light up. So obviously, E minor goes well with E minor. Another thing, this is a new-ish feature with Rekordbox within, like, the last year or two. Fantastic feature. Totally worth the update. When I figured it out, like, probably a little, like, a couple updates too late, I was like, oh my gosh, this is fantastic. Or it was always there and I just never noticed it. But the thing, so people, like, ask me about, like, you know, using Rekordbox versus, like, mix and key. And I think Mix and Key uses the Camelot wheel, which it has, like, the numbers and the letters. It's a different way of doing it. Still kind of similar, and you can actually import that on here. I think, let's see. There's something that you do right here, but we'll go over that another day. Because I don't really remember. I kind of watched a video on it. but it analyzes only a certain part of the track. So if there is a key change, just like if there's a tempo change, Rekordbox won't recognize that, and it'll just do kind of like what the average like key is, or the main key. So like if it is E minor, it's most likely it's like the majority of the track. But if it mixes, if it changes in the middle and you're trying to mix in that one part, you're going to have to learn how to train your ear to mix in key or just mix in a different part. And if there's a tempo change where, like, say it's at 128 and it goes up to 140 and it goes back down to 128, you're going to have to be aware of that too. Always know your tracks. I prefer circle of fifths just because I think it's more of the standard in the music industry. I have a Music Theory for Dummies book on my phone that I have read 5 pages of, but that's what they talk about. So, yeah. Let's see. Yeah, and that's the other thing, too. There will be changes when you change the BPM. So, like, if you take... Here, let's do an example of this. So, 128, which is the normal BPM. I'll change it to, say something dramatic. I'll change it to, like, 160. It's actually not even, like, super, super bad. It just sounds faster. So, 200. But sometimes you'll hear the vocals getting, like, really high pitch and changing. So you have to be aware of that stuff, too. That's why, like, I don't genre hop a lot and, like, change the BPM dramatically. And, well, yeah, you can hear the difference in the BPM. But, like, in a lot of vocals, you have, it'll change... Rekordbox analyzes it, so it's going to be different on here versus, like, on Dex. But you, I'm, like, blanking on what the button's called. Yeah, the master tempo. Thank you. If it's a tad bit higher, you turn on the master tempo, but the master tempo only helps you to a certain degree. So if you still have a 128 track and you're pushing it to 200, because for God forbid, you want to mix, like, this track into a French chord track, it's probably not going to sound good. Do things gradually. So, like, even, like, going from, like, 128 to 140, you can hear that it still sounds, like, pretty good. So, yeah, don't do huge changes. Just do it gradually. Wide or die, stop. So, the other thing too, let me see how I get this other window. Okay. So on this little area over here, you'll see it's got like tags. So you can like tag like genres. You can also add genres because, you know, most of the time hardstyle is not going to be a genre. and then you have display related track list window. This will be like your whole collection. And then you have like the info and then sub browser window, which is like a replica of this basically. So I like having the display related track key window because this is only going to show in this list like what's in key. But if you want to know other stuff that's in key throughout your whole list in case you're not happy with what you're seeing here and you want to add a track, that's what this is for. It's very useful. So, and I'll show you the difference of something that's in key and something that's not, and you may or may not be able to hear it. It's okay if you can't. You kind of have to train your ear unless you're one of those people that's born with it. And if you are, oh my God, it's going to save you so much time. Yeah. I have a story about that, but I can't share it because Talon would be mad. Okay. Yeah, so mixing a key and seeing it visually is going to probably be your best bet. So, obviously, E minor, E minor, going to sound good. So let's use this as an example. I don't know if it's on the beat grid properly. Let me guess I'll find out. So you can hear this track, if it goes to the middle, and it doesn't sound like a fork and knife scraping against a plate. It doesn't sound like nails on a chalkboard. That's good. I'm not gonna say it's gonna sound like one track, but you know, it sounds harmonious. Ah, there you go, got a mix. Okay. So, now let's do something that it says is not in key. We'll use my track as an example. Face My Fears. So this is D flat minor. So the little B, lowercase b, means flat. And the hashtag means sharp. And actually, the kicks over it don't sound super bad, but that's because there's not really a melody in the mix intro of my track. But definitely different energies. So let's try another one. Let's try B flat minor. I'm actually gonna go to more of like mix. Let's see, let's do a mid intro. Because if you have more stuff in it, you might hear it more. It's like I said, sometimes you're not gonna mix at the beginning or the end. You can literally almost hear the keys like duking it out together. It literally sounds like they're fighting together. So I'm sure even if you're tone deaf, if it's like completely no way gonna be in like key, you can probably still hear it to a certain degree. It's almost like when you hear somebody who is not mixing properly and it sounds like their shoes in a dryer because the kicks are completely like offbeat. I don't know. It's just like I can hear and it's like a little cringy. Now, this is also a guideline because like I said, if there's a key change, even if it says it's not supposed to be in key, it may still sound well. You just kind of got to use your judgment. Like even at the beginning when you heard the Face My Fears, other than the change of energy, the kicks over this track still went okay. You could probably get away with it. But then you also have, like, the whole, like, you're going from here to, like, boom, all the energy's being brought down. So you got to think about that stuff as well. And trance is different because you have a totally different style of mixing. And like I said, this is the cookie cutter style of mixing. And I'm actually starting to do different elements of mixing. And I am watching like house and like trance DJs on YouTube because if you can find different styles, you can kind of create your own. So, I will say mixing in key is really important, especially when you're doing a mashup because you're going to do more than just those 16 bars of mixing two tracks together and then cutting one out completely. So it's definitely really important. And for Hardstyle, I want to say the most predominant keys you'll come across are F minor, G minor, G sharp minor, F sharp minor. There are some E minors, some A minors. You don't really get a lot of, I'll just show you like in one of my Hardstyle lists. So here's Hardstyle 1. We'll organize it by key. So you can see a lot of G minors. You got some G, but kind of a shorter list. A lot of F minors. A lot of F sharp minors.
F is also like super short, E minor. You can see like there's very few E flats, E flat minor. And you have a couple like B minors, a couple C minors, but it's important to know that you could just use a track to transfer from one key to another and just use it as a middle ground. Because, you know, say I'm going from E minor and all of a sudden like I go to A minor. So you can see like A minor, E minor, G are all supposedly in key. But if I throw that A minor in there, my next track is A minor, and I go and I do the traffic light for track B, you're going to see now I can do D minor. You can still do E minor. You can do C now. And you can use that to kind of like go into different directions for your music. I don't know what the Ben Nicky technique is. I have some fun stories with him. I'm so stoked. Really nice guy. A little bro-y, but very nice. He was just telling me some crazy funny stories. I'll just like say it. He was talking about, so he used to bring like protein powder with him everywhere, and he would just have it like in a bag, and he would take it on his carry-on. And when you have white protein powder in a bag and you're that one person they happen to search, doesn't really look good. I mean, obviously, like, you know, they tested it and it obviously wasn't drugs, but it was just like a funny look. Okay, so you're talking about like the different like genres that he flips through. All right, so let's go back up. So we have, so also you can organize your track list by like number, which is the order it's in. You can organize it by track title, artist, if it's in there, BPM, the length, the key, the date added. So you can always organize your list however you want if you're trying to find something. You can also search for it right here. So anyways, so we have Can You Feel My Heart, which is the first track. And I'm going to go ahead and go into A minor. I want to switch it up a bit and make it a little bit more of a challenge. Or maybe I might do E minor. Maybe I'll do E minor. I'll do something. Let's see how this sounds. So I have the mix intro. I have it geared up. I have my cue point saved right here. So that's like the first beat. In case y'all are wondering why I have another cue point right here, that is for in case I want to start the track here. It's also a bit of a cheat. Like if I have a track set list and I'm like mixing different genres, I know for sure it's gonna sound best if I mix there. If I miss it, it's not the end of the world. I can mix it later in the set, but it's like a little cheat point. No shame in that. It just kind of depends on the specific playlist it's in. That was good. There was no vocals in my second track, so they didn't clash at all. And I picked this track because even though it starts out quiet, it still has energy and it builds up. Can you get to this point? And I just love this track.
So there you go. That's how I picked my first two tracks. And since I like that, I'm going to actually drag it up all the way, all the way, and put it to number two. So that way I have my order. So I went from E minor to E minor. Another thing to keep in mind too, if you have tracks by the same artist, most likely they will go well together. Energy-wise, key-wise, even if it doesn't always say it mixes in key, or it's not supposed to mix in key, sometimes it still will. But you also don't want to, like, put too many of the same artists, like, in a row as well. So, I'm going to go ahead and go from, let's see, I'm in E minor to, let's go to G. Just another fun track. So, normally I would mix like right here. Oh, I don't have my point save there. You'll see me occasionally trying to cut, which is just hard on a mouse. And we'll see if the vocals flash on this. Not bad. So there you go. It's another like fun, energetic track. Jägermeister. So yeah, just kind of another fun track. No, so, yeah, that's what I use the little, traffic lights for. So you can see that right here, it's got like, so right now it's on track player B, and right now I'd want to pick another track for A. So it switches which things go in key. So right now it says what's in key with G, which is what the track is E minor, G, you even have D. And, that's as far as what's in this playlist. If I go over here, and I click, it's already on A, but if I wanted it on B, I would just switch it. So it's on A. You can even go through here, and sometimes it'll, this is like your whole, like, library. It'll add some other keys in here if you want to, like, see if there's anything else that might mix with it. So that's how, like, if I'm trying to mix in key, that's how, like, I put it in here. Like, I don't have any C tracks in here, but C would mix with it. You have some more choices of D, so that's some examples. But yeah, I mean, you could do like, maybe not an E minor, but you could probably definitely do a whole set in F minor and Hardstyle. And honestly, it's not going to change the energy or like the sound of the set. It's just like, I mean, everything just happens to be in F minor. There's nothing wrong with that. I mean, I'll show you like when I did my hard hub set. Let's turn the traffic light off. You can see like, got E minor, E minor, B minor, E minor, A minor, E minor, and it's like, you know, a little bit of a pattern. But then you get down here and I have some more variation. I've got like G, D, D flat minor, B flat minor. So I mean, don't let that hold you back. Like, don't say, oh, I've got like F minor like 10 tracks in a row, I want to switch it up. You can if you want to, but it's like that rule of thumb with the like a taking a multiple choice test. If you keep selecting D and you know the next answer is D, don't just change it just to break that pattern, you know? So, all right, let's go ahead. So I have, I'm gonna click on that so it highlights anything that's in key. So from G, this is a fun track. Maybe I'll go to D, and that's gonna be a harder one to find something that's in key with. Well, I mean, you're gonna have like at least G, but I don't even have like a lot of G tracks in here. So that'll be a good example of what to do when you get to that point. I wanna click on that first beat. Also, sometimes there's like dead silence at the beginning, so that's another reason why you want to like find that first beat, because like you can't just hit this and say, oh, that's actually the first beat, when no, it's like clearly right here, you can see it.
Jägermeister.
I'm gonna do my shift play to get started when it drops. And there are vocals in both, so we'll have to see if it fits here. And you can see that wasn't very fluent. Hold on one second. My dog is wrestling my cat. Chowder, can you stop? Hey, Talon, can you please take him out to go to the bathroom? Thank you. I think it's been a while. My dog absolutely loves my cat. It's really cute. And my poor cat just takes it. My puppy's like on top of him, like hugging him and licking him, or on his side, on his back and licking him. And Charmin's just like, oh God. So anyways, so that didn't sound well, but you can see that this is one of those scenarios that does not have 16 bars. It actually has 24 bars. So I could try mixing it on the last 8 bars of this mid intro. And we will see if it sounds better there. So let's get this restarted. Hello. I can actually hear a little bit of a key change. That's very minor. So that's a bit better, although I could definitely hear a key clash in there. I don't know if y'all could hear it, but it's so minor that the average person probably wouldn't even notice. So I could leave it there, or I can even try mixing it later. I can like do it in the mix outro and see if it sounds better. But then it's also like, do I really want the whole track to play? Maybe I should try a different track, but I'm just going to leave it as right now. Yeah, but remember, half the people in the crowd are going to be DJs. Today, at least. I am drinking this beer so slow. I can't even tell I've been doing this for an hour and a half. I'm really enjoying this. I will cut it off at some point, because I don't want this to be too long. It's already kind of getting there. So I'm going to do like a couple more minutes and then just cut it off. So we'll go ahead and do the follow me for the fourth track. And you can see how quickly it goes, like once you start going, once you get over the hurdle of like the first two tracks, which is also the point when I start getting over my nerves when I'm playing. I love this. The piano's just so pretty. Standing in the middle of the street. Standing like there's no more time for me. And let's see, I'm gonna switch to player B. You can see how limited I am on this. If you follow me, do B minor, G, D. And very limited list. Over here, it's also not super long. You can see how quickly I can scroll through that. And that's not even all hard sell either. I could probably go into this. Shout out to the Buckness. This will be the last perfect like way to end things. Get a little touchy-feely. But you can see how I went from energy, and it's still fun at the beginning, and it goes into a touchy-feely part. So it's still got like a good like flow to it.
I will follow you.
still not like really fluid, but fairly fluid. Let's see. Question, if you remove anything from the Rekordbox library, does it remove it from your computer as well? I noticed I have all my rock music and everything mixed with your EDM. That might be because it's mixed with iTunes. But no, if you remove tracks, remember, the files on Rekordbox are a duplicate of where the original file is. So you're only deleting it from Rekordbox, not from your computer. Good question, though. So let's go ahead and move this up. Let's see. Follow me. All right. Now will be a good ending point. Time is only 15 years of non-EDM. Yeah, and also, you know, if you wanted to keep it for whatever reason, because, you know, there is a way to, like, you could mix that stuff in if you really wanted to. Could be fun. But just playlists. Playlists to your friends. Like, you know, obviously you have, like, your whole library right here, and that might be something that you're thinking about. Like, you don't want to, like, filter through all that music that you most of the time aren't going to use. But, yeah, I mean, it's kind of up to you. But if you delete them, like, say on iTunes, even then they're not like fully gone if you bought them on iTunes. Like, you can always re-download those later. So say one can make a new playlist folder, trance, and just use the Rekordbox library to make it. There is a way. Let's see, list. No. There is a way to pick, like, I think you can do it just on different playlists. Let me see here. You can actually even, well, no, that won't do anything. So you can change this. And say, you know, you have your music, like, let's see, we graduated in 2006. So you could just kind of, like, change this based on when you first started buying your EDM. And in theory, it should only show the music from that timeline on here. But I don't know if that's when you bought it or if when you downloaded it. It might actually be when you downloaded it. But I know there is a way to edit your collection. I mean, you could, honestly, you could probably do like BPM and you'll know like the odd BPMs on when to delete stuff. So that could be even a faster way of doing it. So the collection's going to be everything that's, like, in your playlist. And probably your iTunes, if it's attached to it. There is, I think, a way to disconnect iTunes so you can just adjust stuff. Because I have a bunch of stuff on iTunes that I don't want, and I never added it to my Rekordbox because of that. I'm not 100% sure on that. I would just say your best bet is probably just to, I mean, honestly, if you have that much music, I would even, like, just go as far as, like, if you don't have any, like, serious, like, gigs coming up, like, maybe after, like, your birthday, just trash everything and then re-drag the folders on here and just only drag what you want to be on there. Yeah, so... yeah, because that's kind of like what I did. And even like when I have like my Hardstyle playlist, if I'm redragging the folder on here, I'll delete all of this and then just redrag it. Just because for me, it just makes so much more sense to, otherwise if there's anything in here that I moved or I deleted, it's just like empty space and I click on it, I'm like, oh, I don't have that track anymore. So it's kind of like a waste of time. So yeah. And also, every few bookings, I would wipe and reformat your USBs just because you're going to have like less erroring issues, and then just put your playlist back on there after you reformat it, just to kind of give it like a refresher. It's like, I don't know. I've had issues where, you know, all of a sudden it'll say like error, or it'll like completely like go like all wonky. And even like with like 8 and 16 gigabytes, which even on older gear, it shouldn't do that. So I find if I reformat it and I refresh it, you know, like maybe like once every 2 months or something, it makes a huge difference. And it's not like you're fully deleting those playlists unless like you've deleted them in Rekordbox. So, and again, like say you have two computers, you can't take the files that are on your USB that are from Rekordbox and drag it onto that computer because they're duplicates. I tried doing that when I was trying to like do a back-to-back with a friend. I was like, oh, I'll just like put all my stuff on your computer and it'll already be Rekordbox. And it just didn't work out, unfortunately. I don't actually know the details on controllers and USBs. I would just get in the habit of using 32, because in theory, you're not going to use more than 32 in a night, unless like something crazy happens and you're playing for like days by yourself, which I don't foresee. So yeah, I would just say don't do bigger than 32. Just get in the habit of that, because like what if you forget that you have 75 and you bring it and somebody has 2000s and it won't read it, or it starts like erroring out and doing wonky things. Just get like 32. You can buy them in bulk. Like sometimes even like Costco has them, or like, you know, you can do Amazon. So yeah, just get in the habit of that. However, the power of the internet, you can look it up, because I have honestly no idea. I don't even know what the capability of the new 2000 Nexus 2s are. And that's what I have. And I still just use 32. Also, there is a way to use SD cards on them, but I've never done that as well either. So, yeah, lots of information. I hope it was helpful. If I can even help, like, an experienced DJ and, like, a newbie kind of person, I feel good. Definitely more talkative when I'm doing this versus my Sonic games, right, Fernando? Oh, so, yeah.